In this lesson, we'll go over the basics of data collection using Pi interfaces. The Pi interface plays a critical role in the Pi system environment. It's the first point of contact for data that originates from external systems and are destined for the Pi system. We've discussed Pi interfaces a great deal in the context of interface failover, but at its core, a Pi interface is in charge of the following tasks. It establishes a connection to its data source, whether it's an OPC server, relational database, or even a Pi data archive. When the Pi interface receives a new value, it timestamps the data, or ensures that a timestamp comes along with the value from the data source. Next, the Pi interface performs the translation from the OPC protocol, for example, to the language of the Pi system, so that other Pi system components like buffering and the Pi data archive can correctly interpret the data. And lastly, data exits the Pi interface and continues its trek through the Pi system data flow. For the majority of Pi interfaces, there are two common components you'll see in their respective folders: the Pi interface executable and one or more batch files. The executable is the program that's responsible for running the Pi interface. The batch file contains specific parameters for a Pi interface instance. For each Pi interface instance running on the machine, there is a separate batch file associated with it that specify the interface's settings. While Pi interfaces are designed to be unattended applications, requiring little to no user interaction during data collection, it's up to people to create these batch files and to run the interface instances. The batch file is just a text file, and the instance is essentially a Windows service that can be started or stopped. There's a tool available that combines all of these tasks: the Pi Interface Configuration Utility, or Pi ICU. We saw this in a previous video when looking for Pi Buffering Manager. Pi ICU displays text boxes like these for users to fill in. In the background, ICU will update the corresponding batch file. Pi ICU also automatically stores a backup of batch file settings in the Pi Data Archive module database. If Pi ICU starts up and detects a mismatch between a batch file and what's found in the module database, it'll alert you and give you the option to choose one version going forward. Pi ICU also has the ability to create Pi points, used for monitoring Pi interfaces. Note that Pi ICU needs security permissions to perform all of these tasks. We'll take a look at more security in the next video. Before we start installing, let's look at a few Pi interface installation considerations, specifically where to install it. This first architecture shows the Pi interface and buffering installed on the same machine as the data source. In terms of connections and security between the data source and the interface, this is the simplest route, as everything is on one computer. Depending on the data source, though, this may not always be possible, especially when the data source is located in a sensitive network or on a high priority computer. And any external programs, like the Pi interface, must be installed on at least a different machine. That is what step B shows. The Pi interface and buffering are on the own machine, separate from the data source and the Pi data archive. We'll adopt this structure when installing on the Pi Int2 server. This last architecture shows all the Pi system components on one machine. This can be seen often for Pi IT monitor interfaces, where one Pi interface observes multiple machines. So far, we've gone over the basics of Pi interfaces, including their responsibilities, the benefits of Pi ICU, and some planning considerations prior to installation. In the next video, we'll start installing the Pi interface.